We want to welcome all those that are watching on the internet throughout the city of Chicago, throughout the nation, and throughout the world. Welcome to New Life Pilsen Church here in Chicago, Illinois. New Life, give them a warm welcome this afternoon. Today, we're going to continue our series on the heart. I want you all to take a look at this video. Si necesita oír el mensaje en español, tenemos nuestros audífonos atrás, en la mesa atrás con Ariza. Puede ir atrás y coge su audífono para oír el mensaje en español. Today we're going to be talking about anger. Everyone say anger. And we know that's a serious subject because sometimes anger can get the best of us, and we're going to be talking about that. Last time we talked about guilt, and that feeling was that I owe you something. I feel guilty because, and you put whatever in, I treated you wrong. I didn't raise my kids the way I should have. I said this when I shouldn't have said that. I felt guilty. Guilty is I owe you. That's the feeling. Every time I see you, I feel like I owe you something. The word told us, though, we need to tell someone about our sins so that we can be healed. Everyone say healed. If you missed that message, you need to make sure you go online and hear that message because that can release some of you. Touch your neighbor and say, share it. Today, we're all going to be talking about is anger. And Webster defines anger as the feeling that makes someone want to hurt other people. When you're angry, you just want to hurt somebody. You know, sometimes you don't even care who it is. You just see somebody and you just want to punch that person. And sometimes you ever been so angry and somebody just walks up to you and says hello and you just want to strangle them. They're like, wait, what's wrong? Calm down. I just said hello. But it's because you're so filled with anger, you just want to hurt someone. And that's what the Webster Dictionary says anger is. It's the feeling that makes someone want to hurt other people. Anger is literally the feeling that you owe me. When you have anger, you have that feeling that you owe me something. You owe me something. You did something against me, and now you owe me. Every time I see you, my blood boils. Every time I see you, my blood pressure shoots up because you make me angry. Some of you may be picturing a face in your mind right now, and then you're like, ugh, if that person was here right now. I know not in this church, amen. We've been delivered from anger. That anger is that feeling that you get inside of you that you just can't get past what that person has done to you. Pastor, I tried. Pastor, I tried to be friends with them. I tried to even avoid them. I tried to walk around them. But every time I see them, I get angry. I get upset. Some of you are looking at your neighbor right now. Why they sit next to me? Amen. The feeling of anger just consumes you, and you can't let it go. Some of you have been in that position. Some of you might even be in that position right now. Anger has just so consumed you, you just don't even know how to let it go. You're trying and trying, and you just can't let it go. Let me share a story with you of a man and his son. He was a little boy who had a bad temper. Not me. I got good temper. Amen. And his father understood that he had a bad temper. So he wanted to teach him a lesson. So he gave his son a bag of nails, and he told him that every time he got angry, every time he lost his temper, was to go into that bag and grab a hammer, get the nail, and go to the fence and bang that nail in the fence. And the first day, the boy had driven 37 nails into the fence. Some of you said, man, I would have driven 50. Amen. Then it gradually dwindled down. The little boy discovered it was easier to hold his temper than to drive the nails into the fence. And finally, the day came when the boy didn't lose his temper at all. And he was so happy. He told his father about it. Now his father suggested that the little boy, his son, would now pull out the nail for each day he was able to hold his temper. So in other words, every time he held his temper, go back to the fence and pull out a nail that you banged in. The days passed, and the young boy was finally able to tell his father that all the nails were gone. Then the father took his son by the hand, and he led him to the fence. He said, son, you've done well. But now look at all the holes in the fence. The fence will never be the same again. The lesson is this. When you say things in anger, you leave a scar just like that was on the fence. You can put a knife in a man and then draw it out. And it won't matter how many times you say you're sorry, the wound is still there. Doesn't matter how many times you said, you know what, I'm so sorry, I said that in anger. But you gave them the knife. You put it in their heart, and some of you might even put it in their back because you've been talking behind their back. I know nobody here. Amen. But even after you say, you know what? I'm so sorry I did that, and you pull the knife out, guess what? There's still a scar left behind. No matter how many times you say, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, forgive me. I didn't really mean to say that. I didn't really mean to do that. That scar in that other person is still there. And this is a tool of the enemy that he uses to destroy your spiritual life. He will use anger. Everyone say anger. He will use anger to destroy your spiritual life. Look what the Bible says. We're going to go into the Bible now. Matthew chapter 6, verses 14 to 15. It says, if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also, everyone say, forgive you. But look at this. Everyone loves that part. But look what the next scripture says. But if you do not forgive others their sins, in other words, the things they did against you to make you angry, your Father will not forgive your sins. The Bible tells us that we have to forgive them. It doesn't say if they did something not so bad. Or only in this case do you forgive them. Or if they've only done it to you three times, you are to forgive them. The Bible doesn't put any limitations. Everyone say limits. There's no limits on forgiveness. Some of you say, okay, Pastor, what are you talking about now? I was good with the other stuff, but now you don't understand, Pastor. This person keeps stabbing me. This person keeps making me angry. The Bible says to forgive them. The word forgive literally means, I looked up the word in the original text. The word forgive literally means to send away like a husband divorcing his wife. That's what the word literally means, is to like divorce yourself from that hurt, that pain, that situation. When there's a divorce, the spouse has lost all legal rights. There's no longer any connections between the two. You might have children. I understand that part. You're connected because of the children. But legally, all other connections have been broken. You are now divorced. Your spouse has no more legal right to your money. And when someone says, amen. They have no more legal right to your house. When you got into the lawyer and you separated and you got a divorce, whatever you settled upon at that moment, that's what everybody walked away with the table, and then it was over with. You separated, never to bring that back up again. That's what the word literally means to forgive, is to divorce yourself from what is causing you to feel angry. When you forgive someone, you're divorcing that little pain that you feel. That every time you see them, you feel so consumed. The Bible says when you forgive them. You divorce that feeling so that you don't feel it anymore. See, God wants you to divorce your anger. Legally let that person go. Let them go. Release them from your mind. Tear up the contract that they owe you something. You see, when you are angry, we talked about that in the beginning, is the feeling that you owe me something. You did me wrong, you owe me now. Now, what forgiveness means is to literally tear up that contract that you owe me something and said, you know what? The debt has been paid. You no longer owe me that pain anymore. I have set you free. No matter what you've done to me, I release you by the name of Jesus Christ. Tell them the debt has been fully paid. Because remember, when Jesus was on the cross, we owed him a great debt that we could never pay. We owed Jesus a debt of sin that we couldn't pay. There was a contract that was on our life that says we owe this. Could you imagine some of you who have a bill, like a house note, a car note, that if the owner, the bank came to you and said, hey, guess what? Hey, Rob, guess what? The money that you owe on this house, we have a contract. You need to pay me such and such amount every month. You owe me a debt. Now, if the bank president would come to me and say, hey, guess what? We like you so much because you're so good looking. Amen. So I want to make sure you're listening. You're like the best looking guy in the whole bank. We're going to tear up that contract. That money that you promised to pay us, that debt that you owe us, look at this, right in front of you. Crip, crip, rip. It's gone. You no longer owe me. You are now set free. You own this house now free and clear. We have no longer any attachments to you anymore. You are free to go about and do what you want. You see, that's what God is telling us to do. When someone has made us angry, they made a contract with us, and now we think they owe us something. And every time we see them, we get upset. What God says to do in forgiveness is to go up to that person and say, you know what? The contract that you owe me something, I'm going to rip it apart in Jesus' name. You are set free. The debt has been paid. You no longer owe me. I am walking now in freedom. That's what Jesus did for you on the cross. You owed a debt that you could never pay. And when Jesus was on the cross, God the Father had a contract on you that says, you owe me this. And there's no way, the Bible says, that we could ever pay. When Jesus went on that cross, he said, Father, give me those contracts. And he ripped it up. He says, they are now set free. And the word of God says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Somebody praise the Lord that you are free from the contract of sin. Now look at this. The Bible also tells us when they sin against you, see what that scripture says? It says, when they sin against you. It doesn't say if they sin against you, or maybe one day they're going to sin against you. The Bible says, everyone say when. Now, when means that it's going to happen. It's going to happen in your life. If it hasn't happened yet, you're a young person and it hasn't happened yet, just live a few more days. It's going to happen. Amen. When? When means it's bound to happen. It is going to happen, just like when the Lions win the Super Bowl. Amen. It's bound to happen one day. I'm still holding faith. Amen. When? When somebody sins against you, when somebody offends you, when somebody makes you angry, it is bound to happen. So don't get all bent out of shape. Oh, man, Sister Cuckoo, man, she did this to me. Don't get crazy because it's going to happen. Well, I thought they was a Christian. They was up in church. It doesn't say only the people in the world are going to make you angry. It says when the people sin against you. So it could be people in the church. It could be people out the church. It could be people in your house. It can be your own children. It could be your wife, your husband, whoever it may be. It says when they encompass everybody. Everyone say everybody. Touch your neighbor and say that means you too. Because the neighbor next to you someday is going to do it. When they sin against you, when they offend you, when they make you angry. So don't get all bent out of shape if it happens. If I do it to you, don't get bent out of shape. I'm human too. I make mistakes once every 10 years. I know. I just want to make sure you're awake. I throw those out to make sure you guys are following me here. But no, it's going to happen. I'm going to make you angry. I'm going to make you angry. You know what? Maybe I didn't like the food the way you cooked it. And, oh, that pastor, he always talks about food, and then he didn't like mine. Ugh, last time I cooked for him. I'm going to make you upset. I'm human. I'm a man just like you are a man or a woman. We're human. We are going to make each other angry. It's a fact, the Bible says. Everyone say fact. We are going to make each other angry. It's how we overcome it. You see, people can say, well, I'm just going to go find me another church. Get up out of here because these people make me angry. Guess what? The church you go to next, they're going to make you angry too. Why? Because we're all humans. We're the same. Wherever you go. It doesn't matter. People will make you angry. The question is, what are you going to do when they do it? See, they might have sinned against you, the person who made you angry, but God is going to teach you a lesson through it. See, they might have caused anger, but God is going to give you a lesson. Everyone say a lesson. You're going to get a spiritual lesson out of it. So instead of being mad about what has been done to you, look forward to the spiritual truth that you're going to learn. Instead of getting angry that somebody has offended you, look to the spiritual lesson that God is going to teach you. Because there's a spiritual lesson in every time someone makes you angry. God is trying to teach you something, whatever it may be. Look at this. A rattlesnake, if cornered, will sometimes become so angry, it will begin to bite itself. That is exactly what the harboring of hate and resentment against others are doing to you. When you corner a rattlesnake in a corner, sometimes it might become so angry, it starts biting itself. What happens is sometimes you get so angry that you begin, instead of hurting others, you start hurting yourself. You start biting yourself. You start causing pain to yourself. And God says he wants to set you free from anger. We think we're harming others and holding our grievances against them, our hates against them. But the reality is, we're causing deeper harm to ourselves. We think we're harming them, but the reality, the Word of God says, we're really harming ourselves because we haven't released the anger. And that anger is eating up our insides spiritually up. I know it hurts when people do you wrong, But don't you think it hurt Jesus when they did him wrong? Don't you think that when they did Jesus wrong, he was the only perfect man to walk on this earth. He's sinned against nobody. He offended and caused pain to nobody spiritually. But what did Jesus say on the cross? Luke chapter 23, verse 34, look what it says. Jesus says, Father, forgive them. Go ahead, next one. For they do not know what they are doing. He said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. When they offended Jesus, when they talked about Jesus, when Jesus could have been angry because they were putting him on the cross to die, Jesus said, Father, forgive them. Everyone say, forgive them. Because they don't really know what they're doing. When someone sins against you, they really don't know what they're doing. Christ gave us the example by showing us that we need to forgive. When we forgive others, we receive forgiveness from God. Now let me share something with you. Don't hold people prisoners in your mind and in your spirit because of unforgiveness. Some of you have locked people up in your mind. You've locked them up in your spirit. You made them prisoners inside of you. And they're eating you up from the inside. Every time you hear the name, you get upset. Even if they just begin to pronounce the name, if the name is Robert, they just say, you're already upset. Don't say it. Man, don't say that name around me. I already told you. Why? Because you locked them up in your mind. You made a prison in your mind of anger and unforgiveness and in your spirit, and you placed them in there and you said, you owe me and you're never going to go until you repay me. And you think you're causing harm to them when in reality, you're causing harm to yourself. Release them. Let them go. And see how God will release you from the things that are holding you down. If you want to be free from mess in your life, then release others from your prison. If you want to be free from the mess that's in your life, then release others from your prison. You go there, you open up the door and say, you know what? I set you free. You are pardoned. You no longer owe me anything. I rip up the contract. I let you go. Because if you don't forgive, the Bible says God won't forgive us. Anger against people because of what they did to you will destroy you. And we're going to end with this. Look at James chapter 1, not Santiago here. Look at James in the Bible. Everyone's looking back at Santiago. What is he doing? Going to put him on disciplina. Amen. James chapter 1, verse 9. Man, we got an amen on that one. I don't know what you're doing back there, Santiago, but there's some people in the back that said amen. James chapter 1, verse 19. Look at it. It says, my dear brothers and my sisters. So y'all don't feel you're left out. Sometimes the women say, man, we left out. James didn't leave you out. He said, my dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. When you see that, you need to begin to take note spiritually. Everyone say everyone. That means you and me. We're all included in everyone. We make up everyone. It says, everyone should be quick to what? Quick to listen. See, sometimes people have a problem listening. Amen. Have you ever been talked to someone who has a hard time listening? You're like talking with them and they're just talking back and you're like, won't you just shut up and listen? How many are you that person that don't listen? Amen. We got some truthful people in the house. Amen. Because you always want to get your point across. You want to make sure that they understand what you're trying to say. And they're always telling you, man, just listen. Let me talk. And then you can talk. You know, this conversation requires two people, not a one-way street. Be quick to listen. Before you get all upset, before you get all, you know, head over heels, before you want to tear your weave off and ready to fight, listen. Everyone say, listen. Maybe there's a misunderstanding somewhere. So be quick to listen. Let them speak. Hear them out. Hear out the whole situation before you ready to make up something in your mind, a judgment. Be quick to listen. See, a lot of people are slow to listen. They're quick to fight, but slow to listen. But the Bible says, be quick to listen and slow to what? Speak. Why? Because remember the illustration of the fence and the nails. Because if you're quick to speak, you're going to say a lot of things, really, that later on you might really regret. That you're like, oh, my God, I cannot believe I just said that. And remember, because once you put the hole in the fence, even though you say you're sorry and you pull it out, there's always the scar. There's always that hole right there, no matter what. It's never the same again. You can try to put little wood filler in it, but it's not the same. The fence is destroyed. So be slow to speak, quick to listen. Let me hear what you have to say. And let me zip. I know for some of us that's hard to do because you're just like, you just want to talk. You know, just bite your tongue. Some of you are going to have a bleeding tongue. Amen. Bite harder if you want to speak. Slow to speak. Don't be so quick, because some of us, we're good. We got a good tongue. Amen. Some of you can tell somebody off real fast, real quick, and have a smile on your face as you're doing it. Amen. Slow to speak, because some of you got that sharp snake tongue. Slow to speak. Slow it down some. Think about what you're going to say before you say it. Think about, is this really going to hurt this person? Am I saying this because I want to hurt them back because they just hurt me? Slow to speak. Take deep breaths. You know, I was reading some articles. You know, some psychologists even say, you know, count to 10 in your mind before you speak. 1, 2, no, 3. Slow. Do whatever it takes to make you slow to speak. Slow it down. Think about what you're going to say, especially if you're in a heated conversation with somebody. Slow. The Bible has given us how we can get rid of anger out of our lives. And also, what does it say? Slow to become what? Become slow in becoming angry. Because if you're quick to listen and you're slow in speaking, you're going to become slow in becoming angry. Because anger is not going to consume you. Because you're going to think about the situation before you speak. And then you're going to allow God to speak to you before you speak. Maybe you need to pray. As that person is talking and you're hearing, Lord, give me wisdom. Lord, give me patience. Lord, give me knowledge. Let God then speak for you. And sometimes the best thing you can say is nothing. You know, someone once says that it's better to let people think you're crazy than open your mouth and remove all doubts. Amen. Some of you will get it when you get home. It's better to stay quiet. Let them think you're crazy. Let them think you're lost at all than to open up your mouth and remove all doubts. Sometimes it's just better to stay quiet. But pastor, what did they walk up? Sometimes it's better. What did Jesus do on the cross when they were hurling insults on him? Stay quiet. Let them. Because God says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. God will take care of you. You are his child. You're his princess. You're his prince. You're a warrior. God will protect you in all situations. You give it over to God. Let God deal with the person. And you walk in freedom from anger in Jesus' name. Let's all stand. Hallelujah. Anger. What's inside your heart? We've been speaking on the heart. Last time we spoke about guilt. This week we're speaking about anger. Some things we got to get rid of out of our heart. We as a church, we need to move forward. If you're angry with the church, release it. Because the church is not a building. You're not angry at these walls. You're angry at the people inside. Release them. Let them go. If you're angry at me, let me go. If you're angry at your mom and dad because of this or that, they didn't do this or that, let them go. Some of them might have already passed on. Release them. Give them over to God. Let them out of your prison. Release the anger. Maybe there's someone who's making you angry at work. Release them. Forgive them so that God can forgive you of your sins. Close your eyes with me this afternoon. Those of you on the internet, says, Pastor, man, I've been dealing with some anger issues. Man, sometimes I just blow up. I get upset so quickly. I want to release this anger. Someone can just do something very minute to me and I get upset. I want to release this anger. If that's you and you're watching on the internet, just raise your hand. I can't see you, but God can. Say, Pastor, why do you ask me to raise my hand? It's so that you yourself know and God recognizes that you recognize you need help from the Lord. Release this anger. Now here in the sanctuary, you say, Pastor, I've been dealing with anger too. That people owe me something. I've been putting it inside of me. It's been boiling up like a volcano. And I'm ready to explode. I explode on my children. I explode on my spouse. I explode on my family. I explode on my coworkers. Some of them are even afraid to say anything to me because they know I can just beat them up with my tongue. But I don't want to be like that anymore. I don't want to be known as an angry person. I want to be known as a person filled with love and joy and peace, the fruits of the Spirit. I want to be free. I want to be free from this anger. There's no shame in it. No one's looking around. If that's you today, you say, Pastor, I want to be free from anger, from this spirit of anger. I want to be released. Let one of my heart. I want God to do heart surgery on me today and release that anger that's inside of me. If that's you here today, just make your way to this altar. We're going to begin to pray. There's no shame in it. There's no shame in it to say, God, release me from this anger. This person has done me wrong and I couldn't let them go. But today I know I have to release them. I got to let them go. I got to forgive them. If that's you here today, the presence of God is in this place right now. You make your way. We're going to pray with you. You will be released. And you will release them. They will no longer be in your prison anymore. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, that spirit of anger, God, that wants to wrap itself around us, God, I pray right now that you release it in the name of Jesus.